Laudetur Jesus Christus. Praise be Jesus Christ, and welcome to this morning's live stream broadcast of the prayer meeting and Angelus with bishops, priests, consecrated persons, seminarians, and pastoral workers at Sacred Heart Church, Manama in Bahrain. You're listening to Vatican Radio. My name is Christopher Wells. I'll be providing the English language commentary for this morning's events. And as we join the Pope's visit, the Holy Father has just arrived at the church. We do welcome all of you joining us through the various Vatican media channels, the Vatican audio or radio app, the Vatican News web portal, or YouTube channel, or via one of our partner stations, including Catholic Faith Network, Ahmad Darshan TV, Shalom World Television Networks USA, EWTN TV, Sunlight TV, Luminous Radio, Catholic TV, Shalom TV India, or Sunday Shalom. Welcome one and all. For those of you watching the video feed, you can see the Holy Father has arrived in the body of the church to enthusiastic applause from the small Catholic congregation gathered here today. The Holy Father was greeted upon his arrival by three young children, accompanied by a religious sister, and received with an offering of flowers. He was then welcomed by the Apostolic Administrator of the Vicariate of Arabia and by the pastor. And the Holy Father is now making his way through the church, greeting people as he goes, shaking hands. It's a relatively small space, and of course people are crowding to get close to the Holy Father and shake his hand, take a picture. This morning's events, after the opening hymn, which you can hear in the background, the Holy Father will open the meeting with the liturgical greeting, peace be with you. There is a greeting from the Apostolic Administrator. Bishop Paul Hinder, followed by a prayer and several witnesses two witnesses, witness testimonies from a pastoral worker here at the parish and from a religious sister. There will then be a reading from the Gospel of John and the Holy Father's address to the religious and pastoral workers here. That will be followed immediately by the Angelus, which the Holy Father will lead. Pope Francis will then give his apostolic benediction and conclude the prayer meeting with a final hymn.
In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, Amen. Peace be with you.
And the Holy Father greets the faithful with the liturgical greeting in English. And we now hear from the Apostolic Administrator of the Apostolic Vicariate, Bishop Paul Hinder.
Welcome to Sacred Heart Church in Manama, Bahrain, where in 1938-39, Sheikh Hamad bin Issa bin Salman al-Khalifa, Emir of Bahrain, welcomed the Catholic community and gave us a place for the construction of the first church on the shores of the Arabian Gulf. The people you are meeting this morning are representatives of a migrant church, not only in Bahrain, but also in Kuwait, Qatar, and Saudi Arabia, all of whom belong to the Apostolic Vicariate of Northern Arabia. Some here have come also from other parts of the Arabian Peninsula. These priests, religious and lay people, represent all those who are engaged in pastoral care in this region, parish priests, assistant priests, religious sisters, catechists, leaders of associations and prayer groups. They also reflect the cultural and ethnic diversity of the migrant church in this part of the world. Many of them are struggling daily, but do so with deep faith, trusting that we are all in the hands of our Heavenly Father. In the Apostolic Vicariate of Northern Arabia, there are currently around 60 priests working among the estimated 2 million Catholics spread across 4 countries. About 1,300 catechists are teaching catechism to more than 16,000 children. All of them work as volunteers, sometimes under very difficult conditions because of the restrictions in some countries regarding religious freedom, work permits, and residency permits. At the same time, even though we are a migrant church in the desert, we are grateful for several positive experiences and encounters in unexpected places, which have assured us of the Lord's presence within us. You will now hear a few witnesses who will give us their testimonies. Holy Father, we thank you most heartily for being with us today, strengthening the faith of these pastoral workers and enkindling the flame of their enthusiasm to serve Jesus Christ in the Catholic Church in Northern Arabia. Shukran.
As Bishop Hinder mentioned, we will now hear the testimonies of a couple of pastoral workers. After the prayer of the Holy Father.
Let us pray. Grant us, Lord God, with the virtues of the health of your Son, accept us aflame with his love, that, conformed to the image, we may merit a share in eternal redemption. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
And the Holy Father, despite the strong pain that he's felt in his knee, rises for the prayer which you just heard. Our first pastoral testimony is from Chris Nerona, a pastoral worker here.
On behalf of my brothers and sisters in Christ, ever since the news of your visit to the Kingdom of Bahrain was announced, we have all been eagerly anticipating your arrival. Having been born in Bahrain, I was baptized here at the Sacred Heart Church. My parents gave me the name Chris, as they were grateful to God and wanted me to be closer to Him, since I was born 10 years after their marriage. What captivated me as a child was the devotion of all the faithful, irrespective of race, color, language, or nationality, all gathering as one family, singing in unison in the Mother Church here in Manama, which would always be filled to capacity. Over the years, the community grew with the building of the new Sacred Heart Church. The community continued to grow in number and in strength, with different groups and ministries being established. In all this, the devotion of the faithful remained firm. I have personally witnessed the trials faced by many migrants who left their families back home to work here so that they could support their loved ones with their meager wages. They toil for hours on end, and their only solace at the end of the day is that they have made a difference with regard to the future financial security of their families. Being so far away from loved ones, sometimes for years at a time, is a true test of faith. And this is where the church makes a difference. We all come together here to pray, asking God to give us strength to overcome these trials. Many want someone to listen to them with empathy as they pour out their innermost feelings of insecurity and fears. I know that we find our peace in Jesus. Watching Sacred Heart Church grow in numbers and in faith over the years is humbling, as I see the commitment, dedication, and energy that many expend through community service. Our shepherds, the priests, have changed throughout the years, but one thing is consistent: the care and concern by which they tend to their flock. I know that I have been blessed to grow up here in the Kingdom of Bahrain, a country where religious tolerance and freedom is a way of life. Thank you for your continued efforts, Holy Father, as you journey globally as a messenger of peace and goodwill. Just like you, may we all seek peace as we light candles of hope, however small, by our words and deeds and prayers, in the hope of a better and brighter future. Please, Holy Father, continue praying for us, just as we promise to pray for you.
That was a witness borne by a pastoral worker, Chris Nerona, who now goes up to greet our Holy Father and exchange a few words with him. And receive his blessing. Our next witness is a religious sister, Sister Rose Celine.
Good morning, Most Holy Father, our beloved and caring shepherd. How can I express my profound gratitude for the rare privilege bestowed on me at this sacred occasion of your pastoral visit to the Kingdom of Bahrain? Your gracious visit shows your care for your faithful flock in the region of the Arabian Gulf, and we feel the warmth of God's fatherly love. I, Sister Rose Celine, would like to give you a summary of our life and mission. The Sisters of the Apostolic Carmel, the first among the Carmelites to be an active mission congregation, has been pioneers in girls' education and faith formation. We began our missionary journey in the Kingdom of Bahrain on 3rd January 2003, following our foundation in Kuwait. Bahrain, known as the Land of Smiles, welcomed us warmly. The compassionate and merciful love of the Father urges us to commit ourselves to the service of our people here. We bear witness to the abundance of God's mercy, which warms the heart and rekindles hope in the lives of many. We involve ourselves in prison ministry. In particular, we spend time with the female prisoners, sharing the word of God, counseling and praying with them. Our presence here is a unique sign that God picks us up from where we are and leads us in new and unfamiliar ways towards our goal. Lived out under our motto, God alone is sufficient. We sisters are involved with the different groups in the church, one of them being the Legion of Mary. The weekly meetings offer us a great opportunity to grow in our spirituality through prayer and community fellowship. We visit hospitals, the sick and needy families. We see that the world around us is changing by leaps and bounds. This rapid change is raising new challenges, and much that was familiar to us is moving into a certain ambiguity. Yet, we respond creatively to the needs of the time by being mediators of change, hope, and transformation, both within and outside our community. To help the youth of today, we have involved ourselves in the catechetical ministry, helping the students in their faith formation so that they may be equipped to respond to the rapid changes around them and face the new challenges that come their way. Opportunities are provided to them by organizing quizzes, talent shows, and various other activities to enhance their leadership, communication, and creative thinking skills. Every year, we prepare students and adults to receive the sacraments of the Eucharist and Confirmation. Our beloved foundress, Mother Veronica, has handed over to us a legacy flowing from her experience of God as our all. Following in her footsteps, we sisters nurture the members of the Carmel Blossoms, our lay association for our students, with greater faith and commitment to Jesus. We teach and share the charism of the Apostolic Carmel through various activities and fellowship, educating the young minds to live and transform the world with the humane values of truth, justice, love, peace, and excellence. Further to all these activities, with the different nationalities, we attend the parish council meetings and participate in all church events. During the pandemic, we assisted the priest to celebrate the Eucharist in different languages. Our Blessed Mother, Queen and Beauty of Carmel, is our model, and she encourages us to efface ourselves in the service of the Church and His people. Thank you, Holy Father, for listening to my testimony.
The testimony we've just heard is from Sister Rose Celine. Her sisters are responsible for much of the education and pastoral work in Arabia and in this part of the Middle East. And now we will hear a reading from the letter from the Gospel of Saint John.
On the last and greatest day of the feast, Jesus stood up and exclaimed, "Let anyone who thirsts come to me and drink. As Scripture says, rivers of living water will flow from within him who believes in me." He said this in reference to the Spirit that those who came to believe in him were to receive. There was, of course, no Spirit yet, because Jesus had not yet been glorified.
And now we will hear the words of our Holy Father addressed to the bishops, priests, consecrated women and men, seminarians, and pastoral workers gathered here in Sacred Heart Church in Manama, Bahrain. The Holy Father will be speaking in Italian with a translation provided in English for those present.
Sacerdoti, consacrati, seminaristi, operatori pastorali, buongiorno. Good morning. Sono lieto di trovarmi in mezzo a voi in questa comunità cristiana che ben manifesta il suo volto cattolico, cioè universale. Una chiesa abitata da persone provenienti da molte parti del mondo, che si ritrovano insieme a confessare l'unica fede in Cristo. Monsignor Hinda, che ringrazio per il suo servizio e per le sue parole, e ha parlato di un piccolo gregge composto da migranti, salutando ciascuno di voi. Allora rivolgo anche un pensiero ai vostri popoli di appartenenza, alle vostre famiglie che portate nel cuore, con un po' di nostalgia, ai vostri paesi di origine. In particolare, vedendo presenti i fedeli del Libano, assicuro la mia preghiera e vicinanza a quell'amato paese, così stanco, così provato, e a tutti i popoli che soffrono in Medio Oriente. È bello appartenere a una chiesa formata da storie e volti diversi che trovano armonia nell'unico volto di Gesù. E tale varietà, l'ho visto in questi giorni, è lo specchio di questo paese, delle genti che lo popolano, ma anche del paesaggio che lo caratterizza e che, pur dominato dal deserto, vanta una ricca e variegata presenza di piante e di esseri viventi.
Dear bishops, priests, consecrated men and women, seminarians and pastoral workers, good morning. I am pleased to be here in the midst of this Christian community that clearly manifests its Catholic face, a universal face, a church made up of people from various parts of the world who come together to profess our one faith in Christ. Yesterday, Bishop Hinder, whom I thank for his service and his words of introduction, talked about a small flock made up of migrants. In greeting you then, my thoughts also turn to the peoples from whom you come, to your dear families, whom you remember with a touch of nostalgia, and to your countries of origin. In particular, since I see that some of you are from Lebanon, I assure you of my prayers and closeness. I assure you of my prayers and closeness to your beloved country, so weary and so sorely tired, as well as to all peoples suffering in the Middle East. It is beautiful to be part of a church composed of different histories and different faces that find their harmony in the one face of Jesus. And this variety, as I have seen in these days, is a mirror of this country, of the people who dwell here in it, but also of its landscape that, though mostly desert, boasts a rich variety of plants and living creatures.
Le parole di Gesù che abbiamo ascoltato parlano dell'acqua viva che sgorga dal Cristo dai credenti. Mi hanno fatto pensare proprio a questa terra. È vero, c'è tanto deserto, ma ci sono anche sorgenti di acqua dolce che scorrono silenziosamente nel sottosuolo irrigandolo. È una bella immagine di quello che siete voi e soprattutto di ciò che la fede opera nella vita. In superficie emerge la nostra umanità, inaridita da tante fragilità, paure, sfide che deve affrontare, mali personali e sociali di vario genere, ma nel sottofondo dell'anima, proprio dentro, nell'intimo del cuore, scorre calma e silenziosa l'acqua dolce dello spirito che irriga i nostri deserti, ridona vigore a quanto rischia di seccare, lava ciò che ci abbruzzisce, dissetta la nostra sete di felicità. E sempre rinnova la vita. E di quest'acqua viva che parla Gesù, è questa la sorgente di vita nuova che ci promette il dono dello Spirito Santo, la presenza tenera, amorevole e rigenerante di Dio in noi.
The words of Jesus that we heard speak of the living water flowing from Christ and his followers. They'd made me think about this very land. While it is true that there is a large expanse of desert, there are springs of fresh water flowing underground that irrigate it. That is a beautiful image of who you are, and above all, of how faith operates in our lives. On the surface, our humanity seems parched by any number of weaknesses, fears, challenges, and personal or social problems of various types. Yet, in the depths of the soul, within our very selves, in the intimacy of the heart, there flows the calm and silent fresh water of the Spirit, who refreshes our deserts and restores life to what is parched, who washes away all that soils us and quenches our thirst for happiness. The Spirit always restores life. This is the water of which Jesus speaks. This is the wellspring of new life that he promises us. It is the gift of the Holy Spirit, the tender, loving, and rejuvenating presence of God within us.
Ci fa bene allora soffermarci sulla scena che il Vangelo descrive. Gesù si trova nel Tempio di Gerusalemme, dove si sta celebrando una delle feste più importanti, durante la quale il popolo benedice il Signore per il dono della terra e dei raccolti, facendo memoria dell'Alleanza. E in quel giorno di festa si svolgeva un rito importante. Il sommo sacerdote si recava alla piscina di Siloe, attingeva acqua e poi, mentre il popolo cantava ed esultava, la versava fuori dalle mura della città per indicare che da Gerusalemme sarebbe fluita una grande benedizione per tutti. Di Gerusalemme, infatti, il salmista aveva detto: «Sono in te tutte le mie sorgenti». e il profeta Ezechiele aveva parlato di una sorgente d'acqua che, sgorgando dal Tempio, avrebbe irrigato e fecondato come un fiume tutta la terra.
It is helpful then to focus on the scene described in the Gospel. Jesus is in the temple in Jerusalem, where they are celebrating one of the most important feasts, when the people bless the Lord for the gifts of the land and the harvest in remembrance of the covenant. On that festive day, an important rite took place. The high priest went to the pool of Siloam to draw water while the people sang and rejoiced. He then poured out the water outside the walls of the city in order to indicate that from Jerusalem would flow a great blessing for everyone. Indeed, the psalmist had sung of Jerusalem, "All my springs are in you." And the prophet Ezekiel had spoken of a fountain flowing like a river from the temple to irrigate the land and make it fruitful.
Con tali premesse comprendiamo bene che cosa vuol dirci il Vangelo di Giovanni con questa scena. Siamo all'ultimo giorno della festa. Gesù si erse ritto in piedi e ad alta voce proclama: chi ha sete venga a me, perché fiumi di acqua viva scorreranno dal suo grembo. Un bel invito, eh? E l'Evangelista spiega quello egli disse dello Spirito che avrebbero ricevuto i credenti in Lui. Infatti non vi era ancora lo Spirito, perché Gesù non era ancora stato glorificato. Il richiamo è allora in cui Gesù muore in croce, in quel momento non più dal Tempio di pietre, ma dal costato aperto di Cristo uscirà l'acqua della vita nuova, l'acqua vivificante dello Spirito Santo, destinata a rigenerare tutta l'umanità, liberandola dal peccato e dalla morte. Fratelli e sorelle, ricordiamoci sempre questo. La Chiesa nasce lì. Nasce dal costato aperto di Cristo, da un bagno di rigenerazione nello Spirito Santo. Non siamo cristiani per il nostro merito o solo perché aderiamo a un credo, ma perché nel battesimo ci è stata donata l'acqua viva dello Spirito, che ci rende figli amati di Dio, fratelli tra di noi, facendoci creature nuove. Tutto sorga dalla grazia, tutto è grazia. Tutto viene dallo Spirito Santo. E allora permettetemi di soffermarmi brevemente con voi su tre grandi doni che lo Spirito Santo ci consegna e ci chiede di accogliere e di vivere. La gioia, l'unità e la profezia. La gioia, l'unità e la profezia.
Against this backdrop, we can better appreciate what the Gospel of John wants to tell us with this scene. It is the last day of the feast, and Jesus stood up and proclaimed, "If anyone thirsts, let them come to me and drink, for rivers of living water will flow from his heart." It is a beautiful invitation. The evangelist explains, "Now this he said about the Spirit, which those who believed in him were to receive, for as yet the Spirit had not been given, because Jesus was not yet glorified." The reference is to the moment when Jesus dies on the cross. At that moment, no longer from the temple of stone, but from the open side of Christ, will the water of new life flow forth, the living water of the Holy Spirit, destined to give new birth to all humanity, setting it free from sin and death. Brothers and sisters, let us always remember this. The church was born there. The church was born from the pierced side of Christ, from the water of rebirth in the Holy Spirit. We are not Christians by our own merit or simply because we profess a creed, but because the living water of the Spirit was given to us in baptism, making us beloved children of God, brothers and sisters of one another, and a new creation. Everything flows from grace. All is grace. Everything comes from the Holy Spirit. Allow me then to focus briefly on three great gifts that the Holy Spirit grants us and asks us to receive and to reflect in our lives: joy, unity, and prophecy. Joy, unity, and prophecy.
Anzitutto lo spirito è sorgente di gioia. Primo, gioia. L'acqua dolce che il Signore vuole far scorrere nei deserti della nostra umanità, impastata di terra e di fragilità, è la certezza di non essere mai soli nel cammino della vita. Lo Spirito è infatti colui che non ci lascia soli, è il Consolatore, ci conforta con la sua presenza discreta e benefica, ci accompagna con amore, ci sostiene nelle lotte e nelle difficoltà, incoraggia i nostri sogni più belli e i nostri desideri più grandi, aprendoci allo stupore e alla bellezza della vita. La gioia dello Spirito, perciò, non è un stato occasionale o un'emozione del momento, tantomeno è quella specie di gioia consumistica e individualista così presente in alcune esperienze culturali di oggi. Invece, la gioia nello Spirito è la gioia che nasce dalla relazione con Dio, dal sapere che, pur nelle fatiche e nelle notti oscure che talvolta attraversiamo, non siamo soli, persi o sconfitti, perché Lui è con noi e con Lui possiamo affrontare e superare tutto, persino gli abissi del dolore e della morte.
First, the Spirit is a wellspring of joy. The fresh water that the Lord wants to make flow in the deserts of our humanity, earthly and frail, is the certainty that we are never alone on the journey of life. The Spirit is the one who does not leave us on our own. He is the comforter who consoles us by his quiet and soothing presence, who accompanies us with love, supports us in struggles and difficulties, encourages our most beautiful dreams and deepest desires, and opens us to the wonder and beauty of life. The joy of the Spirit, however, is not an occasional feeling or a momentary emotion. Still less is it that kind of joy held out by today's individualistic and consumerist culture. The joy of the Spirit, instead, is born of a relationship with God, from knowing that despite the struggles and dark nights that we sometimes endure, we are not alone, lost or defeated, because He is with us. With God, we can face and overcome everything, even the abyss of pain and death.
A voi che avete scoperto questa gioia e la vivete in comunità, vorrei dire conservatela, conservatela. Anzi, moltiplicatela. E sapete qual è il metodo migliore per fare questo? Donarla. Sì, è così, La gioia cristiana è contagiosa, perché il Vangelo fa uscire da se stessi per comunicare la bellezza dell'amore di Dio. Dunque è essenziale che nelle comunità cristiane la gioia non venga meno e sia condivisa, che non ci si limitiamo a ripetere gesti per abitudine, senza entusiasmo, senza creatività. Al contrario, perderemo la fede e diventeremo una comunità noiosa, È brutto quello, È importante che oltre alla liturgia, in particolare alla celebrazione della Messa, fonte e culmine della vita cristiana, facciamo circolare la gioia del Vangelo anche in un'azione pastorale vivace, specialmente per i giovani, per le famiglie e per le vocazioni alla vita sacerdotale e religiosa. La gioia cristiana non si può tenere per sé, No. La gioia cristiana non si può tenere per sé. E quando mettiamo in circolo, si moltiplica.
To all of you who have discovered this joy and experienced it in community, I would say, preserve this joy. Preserve it. Indeed, let it grow ever greater. Do you know the best way to do that? By giving it away. Yes, Christian joy is naturally contagious, since the gospel makes us go beyond ourselves to share the beauty of God's love. It is essential, therefore, that this joy not be dimmed or left unshared in Christian communities, that we do not restrict ourselves to doing things by force of habit, with enthusiasm or creativity. In a community of faith, this is not good. In addition to the liturgy, and especially the celebration of Mass, the source and summit of Christian life, it is important that we spread the joy of the gospel through a lively pastoral outreach, especially to young people and families, and through fostering vocations to the priesthood and the religious life. We cannot keep Christian joy to ourselves. We cannot keep it to ourselves. It multiplies once we start spreading it around.
In secondo luogo, lo Spirito Santo è sorgente di unità. Quanti lo accolgono ricevono l'amore del Padre e diventano suoi figli. E se figli di Dio sono anche fratelli e sorelle. Non può esserci spazio per le opere della carne, cioè l'egoismo, per la divisione, le liti, le maledicenze, le chiacchiere. State attenti al chiacchiericcio, per favore. Le chiacchiere distruggono una comunità. La divisione del mondo e anche le differenze etniche, culturali e rituali non possono ferire o compromettere l'unità dello spirito. Al contrario, il suo fuoco brucia i desideri mondani e accende la nostra vita di quell'amore accogliente e compassionevole con cui Gesù ci ama, perché anche noi possiamo amarci così tra di noi. Per questo, quando lo Spirito del Risorto discende sui discepoli, diventa sorgente di unità, sorgente di fratellanza contro ogni egoismo, inaugura l'unico linguaggio dell'amore, perché i diversi linguaggi umani non restino distanti e incomprensibili. Abbatte le barriere della diffidenza e dell'odio per creare spazi di accoglienza e di dialogo. Libera dalla paura e infonde il coraggio di uscire incontro agli altri con la forza disarmata e disarmante della misericordia.
Second, the Holy Spirit is a wellspring of unity. All those who receive him receive the Father's love and are made his sons and daughters. And if children of God, also brothers and sisters to one another. There can no longer be room for the works of the flesh, acts of selfishness, such as factions, quarrels, slander, and gossip. Be attentive to gossip. Gossip can destroy a community. Worldly divisions, but also ethnic, cultural, and ritual differences cannot injure or compromise the unity of the Spirit. On the contrary, his fire burns away worldly desires and kindles in our lives the warm and compassionate love with which Jesus loves us, so that we in turn can love one another. For this reason, when the Spirit of the risen Jesus descends on his disciples, he becomes the source of unity and fraternity, opposed to every form of selfishness. He inaugurates the one language of love so that different human languages no longer remain distant and incomprehensible. He breaks down the barriers of distrust and hate in order to create space for acceptance and dialogue. He frees us from fears and instills the courage to go out and meet others with the unarmed and disarming force of mercy.
E questo fa lo Spirito Santo, che così modella la Chiesa fin dalle origini. A partire dalla Pentecoste, le provenienze, le sensibilità e le visioni differenti vengono armonizzate nella comunione, forgiate in un'unità che non è uniformità, è armonia, perché lo Spirito Santo è l'armonia. Se abbiamo ricevuto lo Spirito, La nostra vocazione ecclesiale è anzitutto quella di custodire l'unità e coltivare l'insieme, cioè, come dice San Paolo, conservare l'unità dello spirito per mezzo del vincolo della pace. Un solo corpo, un solo spirito e una sola è la speranza alla quale siamo stati chiamati. Nella sua testimonianza, Cristo ha detto che, quando era molto giovane, ciò che l'aveva affascinata della Chiesa Cattolica era la comune devozione di tutti i fedeli. Indipendentemente dal colore della pelle, dalla provenienza geografica, dalla lingua, tutti riuniti in una sola famiglia, tutti a cantare le lodi del Signore. Questa è la forza della comunità cristiana, la prima testimonianza che possiamo dare al mondo. Cerchiamo di essere custodi e costruttori di unità per essere credibili nel dialogo con gli altri. Viviamo la fraternità tra di noi. Facciamolo nelle comunità, valorizzando i carismi di tutti senza mortificare nessuno. Facciamolo nelle case religiose come segni viventi di concordia e di pace. Facciamolo nelle famiglie, così che il vincolo dell'amore e del sacramento si traduca in atteggiamenti quotidiani di servizio e di perdono. Facciamolo anche nella società multireligiosa e multiculturale in cui viviamo, sempre a favore del dialogo, sempre tessitori di comunione con i fratelli di altri credo, con i fratelli di altre confessioni. So che su questa strada voi offrite già un bel esempio, ma la fraternità e la comunione sono doni che non dobbiamo stancarsi di chiedere allo Spirito per respingere le tentazioni del nemico, che sempre semina zizzania.
This is what the Holy Spirit does. And in this way, he has shaped the Church from her very beginnings, starting with Pentecost, when a variety of backgrounds, sensibilities, and visions were harmonized in communion, forged in a unity that is not uniformity, but in harmony, for the Holy Spirit is harmony. If we have received the Spirit, our ecclesial vocation is above all to preserve unity and cultivate it together, or as St. Paul says, to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. There is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called to the one hope. In her testimony, Chris said that when she was very young, what fascinated her about the Catholic Church was the shared devotion of all the faithful. Quite apart from the color of their skin, their country of origin, and their language, everyone was gathered as a single family, singing the praises of the Lord. This is the strength of the Christian community. It is the first testimony that we are able to give to the world. Let us seek to be guardians and builders of unity in order to be credible when we dialogue with others. Let us live in fraternity among others. Let us do so in our communities, valuing the charisms of each person without humiliating anyone. Let us do so in our religious houses as living signs of harmony and peace. Let us do so in our families so that the sacramental bond of love is seen daily in service and forgiveness. Let us do so in the multi-religious and multicultural societies in which we find ourselves as tireless promoters of dialogue and weavers of fellowship with our brothers and sisters of other creeds and confessions. I know that you are already offering a good example of walking this path, but fraternity and communion are gifts that we must never tire of imploring from the Spirit. In this way, we can fend off the enemy who always sows weeds.
Infine, lo Spirito è sorgente di profezia. Gioia, unità e profezia. Questa è la terza. La storia della salvezza, come sappiamo, è costellata da numerosi profeti che Dio chiama, consacra e manda in mezzo al popolo perché parlino a suo nome. I profeti ricevono dallo Spirito Santo la luce interiore che li rende interpreti attenti della realtà, capaci di cogliere dentro le trame a volte oscure della storia della presenza di Dio e di indicarla al popolo. Spesso le parole dei profeti sono sfezzanti e si chiamano per nome i progetti di male e si annidano nei cuori della gente, mettono in crisi le false sicurezze umane, le false sicurezze religiose e invitano alla conversione. Anche noi abbiamo questa vocazione profetica. Tutti i battezzati hanno ricevuto lo Spirito e tutti sono profeti. E in quanto tali non possiamo far finta di non vedere le opere del male, restare nel quieto vivere per non sporcarci le mani. Ma un cristiano prima o poi deve sporcarci le mani per vivere la sua vita cristiana e dare testimonianza. Al contrario, abbiamo ricevuto uno spirito di profezia per portare alla luce con la nostra testimonianza di vita il Vangelo. Per questo San Paolo esorta: desiderate intensamente i doni dello Spirito, soprattutto la profezia.
Finally, the Spirit is a wellspring of prophecy. First, we said that He is a wellspring of joy, then unity, and now prophecy. Salvation history, as we know, is full of prophets whom God calls, consecrates, and sends into the midst of the people in order to speak in His name. The prophets receive an interior light from the Holy Spirit, which makes them attentive interpreters of reality, capable of perceiving God's presence and the frequently obscure course of history and making it known to the people. The words of the prophets are often scathing. They call by name the evil designs lurking in the hearts of the people. They call into question false human and religious certainties, and they invite everyone to conversion. We too have this prophetic vocation. All who are baptized have received the Spirit, and so all have become prophets. As such, we cannot pretend not to see the works of evil so as to live a quiet life and not get our hands dirty. How is it possible for a Christian who wants to live his faith not to get his or her hands dirty? On the contrary, we received a spirit of prophecy to proclaim the gospel by our lives and our living witness. In this regard, St. Paul tells us, desire the spiritual gifts, especially that you may prophesy.
E la profezia ci rende capaci di praticare le beatitudini evangeliche nell'istituzione di ogni giorno, cioè ed edificare con ferma mitezza quel regno di Dio nel quale l'amore, la giustizia, la pace si oppongono a ogni forma di egoismo, a ogni forma di violenza e degrado. Ho apprezzato che Sor Rose abbia parlato del ministero tra le detenute nelle carceri. È bello questo. Una possibilità di cui essere grati. La profezia che edifica e conforta queste persone e condividere con loro il tempo, spezzare la parola del Signore, pregare con loro e prestare loro attenzione, perché là dove ci sono fratelli bisognosi, come i carcerati, c'è Gesù ferito, Gesù proprio ferito in ogni persona che soffre. Tu sai cosa penso io quando entro in un carcere? Perché loro e non io? È la misericordia di Dio. Ma prendersi cura dei detenuti fa bene a tutti come comunità umana, perché è da come si trattano gli ultimi che si misura la dignità e la speranza di una società.
Prophecy makes us capable of putting the Beatitudes into practice in everyday situations, building meekly yet resolutely God's kingdom in which love, justice and peace are opposed to every form of selfishness, violence and degradation. I am grateful that Sister Rose spoke of the ministry carried out for those in prison. This is something for which we should be grateful. And you know what I think every time that I go to a prison? It is by the mercy of God that I am there to visit them. They are there, but I am not. The prophecy that builds up and consoles those prisoners is our sharing our time with them, breaking open the word of God and praying with them. It is our showing concern for them. For where there are brothers and sisters in need, like those in prison, there is also Jesus, who who himself suffers and all who suffer. Caring for prisoners is good for everyone as a human community, since the way in which these least ones are treated is a measure of the dignity and the hope of a society.
Cari fratelli e sorelle, in questi mesi stiamo pregando tanto per la pace. In tale contesto costituisce una speranza l'accordo che è stato firmato e che riguarda la situazione in Etiopia. Incoraggio tutti a sostenere questo impegno per una pace duratura, affinché con l'aiuto di Dio si continuino a percorrere le vie del dialogo e il popolo ritrovi presto una vita serena e dignitosa. E anche non voglio dimenticare di pregare e dirvi a voi di pregare per la martoriata Ucraina, perché quella guerra finisca. E adesso, cari fratelli e sorelle, siamo arrivati alla fine. Che sollievo, no? Vorrei dirvi grazie per questi giorni vissuti insieme, ma non dimenticate la gioia, l'unità e la profezia, eh? Non dimenticatevi. Con animo colmo di riconoscenza benedico tutti voi, specialmente quanto hanno lavorato per questo viaggio. E visto che queste sono le ultime parole pubbliche che rivolgo, permettetemi di ringraziare Sua Maestà il Re, le autorità di questo Paese, anche il Ministro della Giustizia presente qui, per la squisita ospitalità. Vi incoraggio a continuare con costanza e letizia il vostro cammino spirituale ed ecclesiale. E ora invochiamo l'intercessione materna della Vergine Maria. Sono felice di venerare come Nostra Signora d'Arabia. Ella ci aiuti a lasciarsi sempre guidare dallo Spirito Santo e ci mantenga gioiosi, uniti nell'affetto e nella preghiera. Ci conto, non dimenticatevi di pregare per me.
Dear brothers and sisters, dear brothers and sisters, in recent months we have been praying a great deal for peace. In this regard, the agreement signed concerning the situation in Ethiopia is a sign of hope. I encourage everyone to support these efforts for a lasting peace, so that with the help of God, we may continue to walk the path of dialogue and the people may return soon to a peaceful and dignified way of life. At the same time, we do not want to forget about the war in Ukraine, and we need to continue to pray that there will be a quick end to the conflict there. Brothers and sisters, we have come to the end, and I would like to say thank you for these days together. With a heart full of gratitude, I bless all of you, especially those who work to prepare for this journey. Since these are my last public words, I thank His Majesty the King and the authorities, especially the Minister of Justice, who is present with us, for their exquisite I thank all of them for their exquisite hospitality. I encourage you to persevere in your spiritual and ecclesial journey with steadfastness and joy. Let us now invoke the maternal intercession of the Virgin Mary, who I am happy to venerate as Our Lady of Arabia. May she help us always to be guided by the Holy Spirit and keep us joyful and united in affection and love. I am counting on you. Do not forget to pray for me. Thank you.
And with that, the Holy Father's speech is concluded. You heard there when he was speaking in Italian. His appeal for Ethiopia and for prayers for martyred Ukraine. Thank you. And we are expecting now for the Holy Father, after a brief pause, to lead the faithful in the recitation of the Angelus, as is customary for Sunday mornings. And then to bless the faithful before a final hymn. And the faithful rise for the recitation of the Angelus.
Angelus Domini, nunc si habet Mariae.
Et concepit de Spiritu Santo.
Ave Maria, gratia plena, Dominus tecum. Benedicta tui mulieribus, et benedictus fructus ventris tui, Iesus.
Santa Maria, Mater Dei, ora pro nobis peccatoribus, nunc et in hora mortis nostre. Amen.
Ecce ancilla Domini.
Fiat mi secundum. Verbum tuum.
Ave Maria, gratia plena, Dominus tecum, benedicta tui mulieribus, et benedictus fructus ventris tui, Iesus.
Santa Maria, Mater Dei, ora pro nobis peccatoribus, nunc et in hora mortis nostre. Amen.
In verbum caro factum est.
Et habitavit in nobis.
Ave Maria, gratia plena, Dominus tecum, benedicta tui mulieribus, et benedictus fructus ventris tui, Iesus.
Santa Maria, Mater Dei, ora pro nobis peccatoribus, nunc et in hora mortis nostre. Amen.
Ora pro nobis, Santa Dei Genitris.
Ut nimi efficiamur promissionibus Christi.
Gratiam tua, questum Domine, mentibus nostris infunde. Ut qui angelo annunciante, Christi Filii tui incarnationem coniovimus, per passionem eius et crucem, a resurrectionis gloriam perducamus, per Christum Dominum nostrum. The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Blessed the name of the Lord.
Now and forever.
Our help is in the name of the Lord.
Who made heaven and earth.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Thanks be to God.
And the Holy Father concludes with the apostolic blessing in English. That blessing is extended also to those listening in live to this ceremony. And with the Angelus and blessing, the meeting, the prayer meeting with priests, religious, pastoral workers concludes with the Salve Regina.
Gentle and blessed,
at the hymn of the Salve Regina, while the choir and the people were singing the hymn, the Holy Father was brought to a table, and the Book of Honor, which he is signing even as we speak. We have a translation of the message he's writing there. With a grateful heart, I carry. With a grateful soul, I carry in my heart and entrust to the Lord the faces and stories of the brothers and sisters I have met here. May God fill them with the joy of the Spirit, with fruits of unity and peace.
May the love of God our Father poured on us in Christ the Son.
And the choir offers a final hymn of going forth.
Fill our hearts and make us one.
We are one in Christ our Savior. In his death we all have died.
And
in his resurrection,
the Holy Father at this point will be brought to the older Church of the Sacred Heart for a private visit there. He'll be accompanied by members of the entourage from the Secretary of State, by the cardinals who are present, by the Apostolic Administrator, and the Apostolic Nuncio. As the Holy Father alluded to in his address, this is the Holy Father's final public event. There will be a farewell ceremony a little later this morning. After his visit to the Sacred Heart Church, the Holy Father will be taken to the secure air base in Awali. He's expected to arrive at the airport at around 12 noon local time, with a departure for the return flight to Rome scheduled for approximately 12:30 local time, 10:30 Rome time.
Together in your spirit, bought by Jesus' precious blood.
The flight back to Rome is approximately 5.5 hours flight time.
We see its glory as his perfect holy bride.
Sorry, a little off on that schedule. He's expected to arrive at the airbase at 12:30, 10:30 Rome time, and depart at approximately 1 p.m. Local time. He'll be returning back here in Rome about 4:35, if all goes according to schedule. And as this celebration draws to a close, we would like to invite you to visit our Vatican News web portal at www.vaticannews.va, as well as our Vatican News Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram accounts for full coverage of the Pope's visit to Bahrain, as well as other news from the Vatican and around the world. Many thanks to our partner stations, including Catholic Faith Network, Atman Darshan TV, Shalom World Television Networks USA, EWTN TV, Salt and Light TV, Luminous Radio, Catholic TV, Shalom TV India, and Sunday Shalom. Thanks, too, to our producers and technicians here in studio, and thanks to all of you for joining us here today. My name is Christopher Wells. You've been listening to Vatican Radio's live coverage of the Pope's apostolic voyage to Bahrain. Praise be Jesus Christ. Laudetur Jesus Christus.